Power in His name. shines for all to see.
Resurrected me in your name, I come alive to. you for your presence in our lives. We thank you that we get to come into your very presence because you have made a way through Jesus Christ for us to come. We thank you that you have made us your children. Father, we thank you that you are good to us. And because you are good, we can come boldly into your throne room. And we lift up the needs that we have. Lord, we lift up those who are going through surgery. And we ask that you would give wisdom to surgeons, that you would direct their hands, that you would direct their decisions. Lord, those who are in need of healing, we pray that you would reach out your hand and restore and heal, because by the stripes of Jesus, we have been healed. Father, we lift up those who are looking to you for wisdom and favor. Lord, we thank you that favor surrounds us as a shield. That's what your word says. And so, Lord, we pray that you would open up doors for people, for your people, to do your will. Lord, we lift up those in our world that don't know you. Lord, our neighbors, our co-workers, our friends, our family. Lord, this summer we ask that you would give us wisdom. Lord, as we're living before them, as we're loving them, as we're walking out your ways in front of them, Lord, we pray that you would soften their hearts, that you would draw them to yourself, and that you would give us wisdom to when to know to open our mouths and speak into their lives and how to do that. Lord, we thank you for your presence with us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We have some praise reports this morning to share with you. Somebody is thanking God that their parents, who had been in a house for 60 years, they were needing to move. And that move has gone well, and they're settling into the new place, and they're thankful for that. Somebody else is thanking God for the body of Christ who has come around them and helped them as they've been walking through financial issues in their lives, and God has led them through that, and they're seeing success, and they're thankful for the way in which God has helped them bring their finances back into order. And then we have here a grandma who is thankful that her 8 grandchildren have all received Jesus. Let's thank God. Amen. Well, before you're seated, turn to someone and tell them Happy Canada Day. If we haven't met before, my name is Nathan. I'm part of the pastoral team here at Koinonia. We're looking forward to hearing from Pastor Steve and Ken Smid later on this morning. Ken's my brother-in-law. I'm very proud of him and what God is doing in and through his life. And you get to hear a bit more of that later on. So welcome, and we want to welcome you, especially if you're here for the first time, if you're a guest with us. Would ask that you take the Connect card from the seat pocket in front of you, and after the service, take that across the foyer to our welcome center, and we've got some people there that would love to meet you and answer questions you may have, and we've got a gift for you as well. And if you have a prayer request or a praise report, or if you need to update your contact info at some point, you can fill out that card as well. Well, we're looking forward to a great morning this morning, and right now we're going to celebrate covenant partnership.
Before we celebrate communion together, we are going to welcome a couple more covenant partners. We did in the first service, Bruce and Jesse Luloff, and in this service, Tom Lee Gray. Covenant partnership is important to us as a body of Koinonia. We take from the book of Philippians, first chapter, 5th verse, is one of the usages of the word koinonia. And it says, Paul is giving thanks in all of his prayers with joy for the people, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now. That word fellowship is koinonia, but one of the definitions of koinonia is partnership. So we use that word in regards to covenant because God is a covenant-keeping God, and it takes two to keep covenant. And fortunately, over the generation, God has kept covenant even when we were not faithful. He remains faithful. But he does call us to be a covenant people as the body of Christ. Covenant in with one another, covenant in our marriages, covenant in the way we relate to him. And so that word is used to us to describe for covenant partners, those that are saying, we recognize that it's not somebody else's job to build the local church, touch our community. It's our responsibility as well. And so we talk about four things. One is that we embrace our placing. We believe that God has set us here. Where he has planted us is where we're best able to blossom, bloom, and flourish. Secondly, that it's about relating. It's not just about attending. It's about actually getting to know one another and to realize that we're looking for the treasure. But in any relationship, when you get really close, you find some of the dirt that's there as well as the treasure, but you keep digging for treasure. And the third thing is about area of serving, and that is in any family, we serve and bring our gifts to bear because we're in training to be servants in the world. Jesus said that he didn't come just to be served, but to serve. And in a world that wants to be served, we're to come in an opposite spirit and to serve. And just because we serve someone doesn't make them our master. We have one master, and we do all things as unto the Lord. And the fourth aspect is about leading. And that's the statement that really says we recognize that we're called to be builders of the house of God as well, for other people to find a place of safety, a place of protection, and a place where they can explore and find out about the love and the life of God so that we can touch our community, our province, our nation, and even around the world. So I have three questions to ask you this morning. A couple of our elders are behind you representing eldership of the church. And these are questions that are not new questions, but we just ask them publicly so that we can just affirm. Number one is, do you acknowledge the Lordship of Jesus Christ in your life? Second, do you commit to bring the gifts that God's given to you to the body for the benefit of the body? And the third is, can you recognize that the leadership of the church that God's given to us is for your blessing? So we want to pray. So would you stretch out your hand towards Tom and Lee this morning? Father, we just thank you for Tom and Lee. We thank you, Father, for you are the one that called and sat in place. And as they embrace and say yes today, Father, we just cover them right now with prayer and blessing. We pray, Father, whenever we step in and say yes to you and in deeper commitment, Lord, there's a greater release of your grace. Whenever we put a demand in humility to realize that we need one another, there's a greater release of your grace. So, Father, we just speak blessing over them, over their lives, over their marriage, over their family, over their household, and all the people that they would touch that are in their world that we may or may not meet. But, Father, you will speak in them, to them, and through them. And, Lord, we pray for your protection, for health, and for strength upon their family. We pray, Father, that you would release your blessing and your grace through them to others, Father, in even greater measures in the days ahead. We give you thanks and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 So be it. Bless you. Love you. Love you guys. God bless you. You know, as we celebrate the communion table together today, this table of fellowship, I want to read a couple of verses for you from Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 17, beginning of verse 19, sorry. It says, therefore, brethren, having boldness to enter the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way which he consecrated for us through the veil, that is his flesh, and having a high priest over the house of God, let us draw near. First of all, he talks about that our boldness in coming to the throne of grace is because of the blood of Jesus Christ. And it was the cup that Jesus held up and said, this represents my blood. When he took the bread, that is his flesh, he said, this is my body, which is broken for you. He gave new meaning to that fourth cup that sat empty. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And then there was a fourth cup. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, there's the generations that they would celebrate, but there was the coming Messiah. And Jesus was saying to them, this is me. And they didn't really understand that at the moment. It was a progressive revelation as the Holy Spirit began to bring it alive, and they remembered the words that Jesus had spoken and said to them. But we celebrate communion, the fact that it is through the blood of Jesus that we have boldness to come to the throne of grace. It's what he's done, not what we have done ourselves. It's at that place that we set aside the shame that often is there, or the fears that can grip us, and we set them aside, we lay them aside. And then it goes on and says, but let's draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith. Let's hold fast the confession of our hope. and let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. We have faith, hope, and love. And then verse 25 says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. You know, we can look at this scripture and we say, well, yeah, it's important for us to come together and fellowship as a church. And that's true. But there's a deeper thing that's being said here. When we assemble together, every time we assemble together, we remind ourselves that it's not just about us. The broken part of humanity that we all share in common is that we like life to be all about us and our needs and our preferences and our desires, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And that doesn't magically disappear when we got saved. Have you noticed? So it's still a default. It's a natural default of the flesh. However, we're called to be those who will walk according to the Spirit and to yield to Him. So every time we assemble, we get together, we gather, we assemble. You see other people coming into the parking lot. You see other people when you're walking into service. We're worshiping together. It's a reminder that it's not just about us. It's about the bigger thing that God is doing in the world among us and out farther than what we can actually visibly see. But the body of Christ is worldwide. And as we gather around the world today to celebrate this first day, the Lord's Day of the week, we do so reminding ourselves that it's about Him and His plan, His purpose for our lives. As we have served the elements, I want you to hold those if you would, and we'll receive those together. But as we do, preparing our hearts, I want you to listen to the words of the song. Stacy sings this. Let the words personally grab a hold of your heart and speak to you.
Scattered ashes that I hid away.
Stacy. And where's that song, I laid my life down? And it's talking about death. It's really talking about laying our own lives down. Jesus said, unless we lay our life down, we try to save our life, we'll lose it. But if we lose our life for his sake in the gospel, we'll gain it. We gather around the table to remind ourselves that life is not about just us. It's a bigger picture. That God is at work in the world. But it starts with the realization that we set our own desire apart and say with Paul, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, but not I who lives, but Christ who lives in me. So that when we take the bread and we eat it, we realize that it speaks about the body of Christ. That one translation actually says we are one body. It says we are one loaf. We are made one in Christ. One sacrifice of his body and of his blood for all who will believe and receive. Today, as you eat the bread and then drink the cup, let's use the words of Jesus to declare, not your will, but mine. Not my will, but yours be done. All right? Your will, God, will be done. Father, we thank you today. Thank you for the reminder of what Jesus has done on our behalf, and the reminder that we have laid our life down and to lay it down each day in order that we might live the life that you've called us to in Christ Jesus. We ask you to lead us, to guide us, to direct us, and to continue to live your life through us, that we might be agents of reconciliation to those who do not know you. But we rejoice in your goodness to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, we're going to continue worshiping God with our giving this morning. Thank you if you've already given online or at one of the kiosks out in the foyer by the resource centers. You know, we have the greatest message of all messages. Do you agree? We have the message of Jesus Christ to share with people, the message of the gospel. And God has called us to do that everywhere we go. One of the ways we share this message is through KidZone. And you heard about that last week if you were with us. KidZone is a after-school program that goes into a couple of community centers in Kitchener. And those kids that we're ministering to there, that we're sharing God's love with there, they don't typically come into a church building, but they're part of our congregation. Right, Otto? And we're going into the community to share the love of Christ with them. And last week we had a fundraiser because we're raising funds for over 50 kids to go to Blaze Day Camp. Because when those kids are in that camp, they're going to have a concentrated time of hearing about the message of Christ, hearing about the message of God's love, and we're going to be able to help them see how much God loves them. So far, we've raised $2,200 for that, and we need around $10,000 in order to send all those kids, and that's what we want to do. So we want to invite you to continue to support KidZone throughout the year, but particularly right now, if you're able to, let's continue to support that camp so that those kids can come and experience the love of God from July 10 to 14 here at Koinonia. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your generosity with us. We thank you for the love and the message that you have given to us to share. And we pray that as these kids come and experience your love in this camp, that their lives would be transformed by the message, just like our lives have been. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Summer is just around the corner, but if we're not careful, it can catch us all unprepared-like. It's summer! What do I do? But with the right preparations, summer can be a blast.
Yeah!
Hoorah! Now imagine, not only are you prepared for summer, but you're also signed up for some of our Summer in the House events.
Yeah! Woo! Yes!
We'll be right back.
Well, if the summer events are as much fun as that video, you don't want to miss them, right? It makes me laugh every time. We have a number of summer events and camps for youth and kids throughout the summer. One I want to, in particular, highlight for you is VBS, which this year is called Blast to the Past, or Blast to the Past. Yeah. Vacation Bible School. So that's happening from July 10 to 14, 9 a.m. to noon, and it's for kids who are age 4 up to grade 6. You know, in our culture, in our society, our kids are continually bombarded by messages, aren't they? Messages about who they are and who they should be and what they should want. Well, we have a message. God has a message that we need to impart to these kids. We want them to have a strong foundation. We want them to have a biblical worldview. And as parents, we need to be strategic in making sure that happens. And so this Vacation Bible School, this week-long Vacation Bible School is an opportunity for us as parents to help shape the way our kids see the world through God's worldview. And so I encourage you to make sure you take advantage of that. You can sign up online or at the Resource Center. And in addition to the events we have for our kids and youth, we have something for the ladies and something for the men. In July, we have a men's barbecue and motorcycle rally happening for grade 7 and up. And then in August, we have a ladies' divine pool party for ages 18 and up. And for both of those, you can go to the Resource Center and sign up, or you can go online and sign up. Right now, we are going to dismiss our Koinonia kids and our Impact 7 and 8 youth. So if you want to stand to your feet, let's continue to worship as they're dismissed.
This heart opened wide from the depths, from the heights.
ask you to join together singing "O Canada." We are blessed to live in Canada. I don't know if you've traveled much at all, but sometimes if people don't travel very much, all they see is the bad in our land. I remember coming back from one trip where I was never so glad to see Canada. I literally got down to Pearson and kissed the ground. And, you know, I realized that even before I'm a Canadian, I'm a Christian, which makes me more passionate about my land and about the people of the land. God always puts the value of any country in its people, not in dirt. It's the people. He made us out of dirt. You are the most precious dirt on the planet. All right? There is no other dirt like you. As we sing this, you know, there's a line that says, "God keep our land." And I want to invite you to lift a hand to heaven and make it a prayer, because that's what it is. And a blessing. And speak blessing over our land as we sing this. But let's do so. Let's join our voices together. Oh, Canada, our home and native land, true patriot love in all our sons command. With glowing hearts we see thee rise, the true north strong and free. From far and wide, O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. God keep our land glorious and free. O Canada, we stand on guard for thee. O Canada, we stand on guard for thee.
Amen.
Yeah, you can clap. Yeah. I know I'm going to go to the soccer game, football game, hockey games, whatever games, and to sing the national anthem. I want you to realize that as a believer in Jesus, you can sing that a little different and speak blessing over our nation. Do you know there's another verse? There's been a few renditions over the years before they settle on the one we sing most commonly today. But there's a second verse that we don't sing very often. It goes like this. Almighty love, by thy mysterious power. It's talking about God. God, he is love. Almighty love, by thy mysterious power, in wisdom guide with faith and freedom dower. Dower is a slang of dowry. It's talking about God giving a dowry to his bride. Be ours a nation evermore that no oppression blights, where justice rules from shore to shore, from lakes to northern lights. May love alone for wrong atone, Lord of the lands, make Canada thine own. Lord of the lands, make Canada thy own. Our anthem is a prayer. And it was meant that way as it was written many, many years ago. And so I invite you, we're gonna pray for our land right now. We pray for Canada. For those of you who participated in the 150 hours of prayer leading up to July 1st, I want to thank you for a partnership in that. But we need to continue to pray for our country. We have a responsibility and a privilege to be Canadians, but there's a lot of work to be done within our own borders and around the world as we continue. But let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come before you today, and we are grateful for this land that you provided, where we can worship you with freedom and truth. We pray, as the scriptures instruct us, that we might continue to dwell together in peace. And Father, we pray that your life and your love might be made known to all the people of Canada. Father, for those that join us from many parts of the world, Father, they find a place of safety and security here. But Father, we pray that they would also find you here. For you are the giver of life. You are the one who imparts destiny and purpose to every person. We thank you for life. We thank you for the freedom that we have to worship and to live our lives before you. And And Father, we pray that we might continue to live in peace and continue to be able to uphold your righteousness in the land. Father, we pray for strength and pray for alongside the local churches right across our land today from the East Coast to the West. Father, we pray that for in each congregation, Father, that you are doing a deep work in each of our hearts, that we have a passion for you and for our country and for the nations of the world. For you've called and sent us to go to all the nations. And Father, we give you thanks that today we have the privilege to stand before you and to give thanks for this land in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Go ahead and take your seat if you would. One of the scriptures written on parliament buildings is from Psalm 72, verse 8. And he shall have dominion also from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. And that's the scripture whereby we were called the dominion of Canada. Our country is also our mission field. And so I want the ushers, if they would, to hand out. We have some prayer maps of Canada to hand out. We got enough for each family. And so if you do that, just as I share a few things. This is put up by Every Home for Christ, and it's a reminder to pray for all the provinces and the territories. There's a good map on there just to be familiar with the cities and some of the cities that we're praying for. It's set out as a 30-day prayer map, but we can continually pray through the scriptures and be encouraged to continue to lift up unity amongst our provinces and territories. You know, we're called to go to the nations, but the nations are also coming to us. And that's very plain for us to see. We realize that Canada, I think we need to realize, is not just about, you know, who we are today. The fact that we celebrate 150 years means that none of us were here when it began, nor do we have a complete history, only what is left before us, what others have told us, and what others have done before to give us really a great country to live in. And we want to be thankful for that and then live to make a difference. So we have a little saying here called NPP, which means what? No perfect people. But guess what? There's no perfect nations either. And so there's been a foundation that's been laid. We have a good reputation throughout the world. But reputations are both good, bad, and the ugly of the journey. If we were to sit down and want to talk about your past or mine at great detail, it probably wouldn't be a lot of fun. The good news is that we're not bound to our past, the mistakes of the past, or what we have done or said or neglected to do. And we need to appreciate, I think, the lessons of the past because they cannot be changed, but we can choose to build a better tomorrow. It's the gospel message that offers hope to all men through repentance, through forgiveness, and then freedom from the past. We are not just simply victims. That is not to be the predominant language of us, victims because of our past. We all could enter there in varying degrees. But it's only the gospel that actually allows us to be set free from our past and what others have done. And we truly have become victims, but into a place to find out we can be victors in Christ. That's our opportunity. It's our opportunity to build upon what others have built and to honor and be thankful for them. And because I wonder what history will say of us today. Someday people will be speaking about us, about what we did, about what we did not. In Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 47, we see something of the heart of God as a people who are sent into bondage, into the exile. They have gone into exile because they've been taken over by another nation, and they had not been serving God and had lost his protection, and they've been taken into exile. But they could live their lives as victims in a foreign land, or they could do something different. If we understand who we are as Christians, that this is not our home, this whatever years we have, but we are made for eternity. So everything of value is not just what we have in our hands right now, what we can see or touch. And so they were called to live not as victims in a foreign land. They were told to marry, for their children to marry, to build houses, to eat, to drink, to work. And then they were to pray for the peace of the city where they were in exile. If that is true, then God is saying to us, no matter circumstances of life, we are to go on and build and occupy until he comes. And we are to not live as victims, but to actually pray for the peace of whatever city you find yourself in, whatever province or country or nation, to pray for the peace of that and invite God to come in to that nation. We're told to pray, first of all, for all people, those who are in authority specifically, in order that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life. And that is a privilege for us in Canada, not a right to be taken lightly, but a privilege to continue to stand and believe God for. I've asked Ken Smith to come and share with us this morning. Ken is the director of True North Aid. Ken grew up on a farm in Eastern Ontario, was working in this area, attending Laura Road Christian Fellowship. And he met and married his wife, Deb, who was attending here. And they moved to Ottawa shortly after, worked on staff at a church with evangelist Bill Prankard. Returned back to Ottawa for a time, went back to KW, then back to Ottawa to assist with National House of Prayer for a couple of years. And then came back here again and was asked if he would take over this aid organization. And so he's been getting an interesting viewpoint into what's going on in the north, particularly of our country. And I've asked him to share some things with us tomorrow. Would you welcome Ken as he comes to share?
Well, thank you once again, Pastor Steve and Beth, for the opportunity to share here this morning. The last time I shared from this platform was 13 years ago when I said, I do, to my beautiful bride, Deb, and kissed her for the very first time. In fact, I kissed her three times. And for those of you who don't know me, I'm married to Deb, and Deb is Nathan's sister, Pastor Nathan's sister. I'd like to begin this morning by telling you about a young man that I met last Friday in northern Saskatchewan. His name is Tyrone, and he told me that at the age of 14, he put a gun to his head, and in an utter state of hopelessness, he pulled the trigger. But for some unknown reason, that day, the bullet didn't fire, so he decided to throw it in the outhouse. He decided he couldn't kill himself, so he might as well drink, and would spend the next 10 years of his life as a hopeless alcoholic. I'll come back to Ty in a little bit. The next day, last Saturday, I met with a young girl. Her name is MJ. She's 13 years old. I was asking her about her life, her family, and her future. She went on to tell me that she has no idea where her mother is, and she seemed quite uncertain about the other members of her family. Later on in the day, I spent some time in a cafe with a number of people, including four Indigenous women. Three of these women had these two little girls with them around the ages of maybe 3 and 6. So I was asking them about these girls, where they were from and their story. They went on to tell me that they collected the three-year-old girl just the day before from a park. Her mother nowhere to be seen, hopelessly addicted to crystal meth. These stories represent what thousands of Indigenous First Peoples living in northern communities in Canada face every day. And I certainly wasn't prepared for the appalling, overcrowded living conditions that I experienced in a northern Ontario community I visited this past January and saw the state of despair that so many find themselves in. And Jim, you certainly would know what I was talking about. If I hadn't taken on the role as National Director of True North Aid, an aid agency dedicated to providing practical support to northern communities in Canada, it would be a lot easier just to ignore and turn a blind eye that this is a reality in Canada and to go on with my life. The social chaos, the sexual and physical abuse, and the suicide packs are all too common in the north. This past January, three 12-year-old girls took their lives in one community in Northern Ontario. Can you imagine? In March, I had the opportunity to visit a community on Baffin Island in Nunavut, Canada. Cape Dorset is known as the Inuit art capital of the world, but it's also known for its suicides. Annie was a resident of Cape Dorset. She was an artist there, and she was launched into world acclaim because of her artwork and the way she was able to depict the abuse and the sadness that so many of her Inuit neighbors, friends, and family face every day. Despite Annie's fame, she too had become a hopeless alcoholic, and last September she was found in the Ottawa River. But you see, a very short distance away from where Annie died is the seat of the Government of Canada. You can see Parliament Hill from that spot. And a few hundred meters in the other direction is where Deb and I had the wonderful opportunity to serve on the mission field as staff at the National House of Prayer. I would walk by that spot most mornings during the week as I would go for my walks with the Lord. Day after day, we had the opportunity to lead hundreds of Christian believers from across the country onto Parliament Hill to meet with members of Parliament, to meet with their senators, and to be watchmen on the wall as we sat in the galleries watching and praying for those that represent us and seeing them hard at work. It was here in Ottawa that I was also able to witness firsthand the rapid erosion of our religious freedom and also our right as parents to teach what we believe to be right and true, our values, our convictions to our kids. And it really should be a concern to every one of us. And yet, as I watch these leaders wrestle back and forth each day in that place of prayer, I ask the Lord to give me a heart for them. That I wouldn't see them through the lens of the media, that I wouldn't see them through my own bias, that I wouldn't see them even as my enemy, but rather I would see them through the lens of God's all-sufficient grace and his unconditional love, and as servants of the people. It was amazing how God began to change my heart and give me a new perspective. For example, I would look at Justin Trudeau not as our prime minister, which he is, but I began to look at him as a man, as a husband, a father, as a man created in the image of God, fearfully and wonderfully made. I began to look at the people who serve us there, not there because of their own interests, but people there who really believe they can make Canada a better place. They're just doing it through what they believe to be right and true, through their values and their conviction. I realize that it's not their job to fix the social chaos that's facing many northern communities in Canada, nor was it their job to repair the social fabric of Canadian society, but that we as the church have that responsibility and a unique opportunity to play our part in the process of reconciliation and restoration in the land, as we all have been called to be ambassadors of hope and ministers of reconciliation. You see, the government's solution to hopelessness might be euthanasia, but God's answer to hopelessness is always Jesus. We cannot look to the government to save us, and no matter how hard we try, you cannot legislate righteousness. Moses tried it. It didn't work. The letter of the law kills, but the spirit of the law brings life. Paul urged young Timothy to pray for all men, especially those in authority. And as they serve us, we get to serve them in this way, because at the end of the day, we all need salvation through God's amazing grace and a whole lot of wisdom. Serving those in authority as the church was best demonstrated one morning at the National House of Prayer. Just after the 2015 election, the doorbell rang. I answered the door that morning, and there were three men in suits. The man in the middle said to me, "Hi, I'm so-and-so, and I've just been elected in a riding, actually here in the GTA, and I'm heading up to Parliament Hill to be sworn in as a member of Parliament. I've heard about this place. I've never been here, but I was wondering if you, the church, could pray for me and bless me before I go up to the hill to be sworn in." He represents one of many believers who serve us in positions of authority at many levels of government in our nation. Another fun example is a group of young people who were up on Parliament Hill during the night praying. An RCMP officer pulled up beside them and said, "What are you doing here?" They said, "Well, we're here to pray." And he replied and said, "Wow, I was just praying in my car that God would send someone here to pray." I've got so many amazing stories of God at work in Canada. And the National House of Prayer is just one of many organizations representing a multitude of people, believers who are voices crying out in what sometimes feels like the wilderness. Many of them are young people doing incredible things inspired by God. I think of a young man that I know, and because of his faith and the values and the convictions that come from that faith, on a regular basis goes before parliamentary committees, Senate committees, and has also stood before the Supreme Court of Canada, defending the values that we believe to be right and true that will ensure a healthy Canadian society. I think of a young woman, a good friend of mine by the name of Fatine. She leads massive prayer rallies throughout Canada, with one yesterday in Kingston, and leads hundreds of young people onto Parliament Hill every year throughout the years to meet with, to pray for, to bless and encourage the men and women who serve us there. These are just a few of the many people who are doing God's work. You see, Tyrone, the young man that I talked about earlier, his life didn't end with drinking. After 10 years, he told me he was laying in a hospital bed in northern Saskatchewan. He said his hands were black, his feet were black, his body was yellow, his liver was about to explode. And his girlfriend walked in the door and she said, "Ty, I want to marry you." And he said, "You can't marry me. I'm going to be dead in a few days." And she said, "No, you're not. I'm going to pray for you." Miraculously, Ty recovered. He went on to get married, to get a very good job that he's had for many years. And he's also been given the flexibility to travel into many northern communities, into some of the darkest places, ministering hope to his own native people. He seeks out those young people who have attempted suicide to minister in particular to them, to mentor them, love them, and pray for them. As we traveled together through a community delivering food packages to agencies that he was involved with, food packages that we were able to provide as an agency, he was telling me about his son in the back seat of the truck. His young son, still a teenager, would go out every night hunting. But what his father didn't know was that he would take the meat he had collected, he would wrap it up, and he would put it in the freezers of many young mothers in the community who were struggling. I find that awesome. You see, as I look beyond the problems and the challenges, and I see our Indigenous neighbors in the north through the lens of God, rather than through the lens of the media, the lens of the world, and oftentimes my own prejudice, I see an incredibly strong, kind, and resilient people. I see a people with strong values and convictions, and I am learning far more from them than they could ever learn from me. That same love that I asked the Lord to give me for those who serve us in positions of authority on Parliament Hill is now being applied to how I see my Indigenous neighbors in the north and their very, very important place here in Canada. Yesterday was Canada Day, a national day of celebration. And yet for many, it was a reminder of how colonialism tried to take away their identity, their culture, and their land. And through the process of assimilation and residential schools began a long and painful history that will take a great deal of reconciliation and forgiveness to heal the trauma that resulted. But as my new friend Ty told me, God always forgives. There is always healing. There is always hope available. And we can look forward. And we, the church, can be agents of that forgiveness, that hope, and that healing. Last Friday, I received a call from an elderly native man. And he received my business card from somebody, and he thought he should call me and have a chat. He told me that 39 years ago, the year I was born, he was hopelessly addicted to alcohol, to cigarettes, and to swearing. On one particular weekend, he was at the end of his rope. He was ready to kill his family and kill himself. But on Monday morning, he had an encounter with Jesus, and his life has never been the same. He said, "I've never touched any of that stuff ever again. Why would I need to? I have Jesus." He told me that he now travels into northern communities, ministering to his own people, bringing the message of hope, paid for by his old age pension. Despite the conditions I saw in Attawapiskat, a community that we've all heard about in the news, I met a man who's become a very good friend of mine. His name is Steve. For many years, Steve and his friend Louie have been coaching and mentoring a young group of boys, a bantam hockey team. Steve gets frustrated sometimes because he doesn't feel he has a lot of help, but he knows what he's doing is important. He knows that by spending time with these boys and coaching them, he's bringing them hope, he's giving them purpose, and he's keeping them out of trouble. Steve's become an important mentor to these boys. He received a college education actually here in Kitchener and works at the elementary school in that community. Steve calls me from time to time and he often says, "You know, Ken, I'm not a spiritual man. I'm not a religious man, you know." He goes, "My praying happens out on the land where I'm most at home, where I'm most comfortable. And I've made a decision. I'm not going to focus on the past." True North Aid is partnered together with a number of hardworking Oakville residents. And this Thursday, we will come alongside and strengthen Steve's efforts and be part of that ministry of reconciliation as we bring a group of 14 boys from Attawapiskat to Oakville for a four-day mixed hockey tournament with cultural exchange experiences. And then in November, these Oakville youth will go to Attawapiskat to learn their culture and to strengthen their relationships with these boys. This was an idea of a young lady in Oakville, a businesswoman who had this thought, and she came to us asking if we could help. Throughout Canada, I am discovering in both the North and the South dedicated individuals committed to creating something better together. A people who are determined to bring change, and it's my heart, and I believe it's our heart, our job, to come alongside and support the Tyrones, support the Normas, support the Steves, and the Lindas, who I was able to help start a food bank last week. Support them and serve them, whether they're spiritual or not. You see, despite what we see and hear, there are so many making a difference. And I'm looking for those that I can come alongside to serve and support. It is yet to be determined if I can do what I'm doing full-time or part-time or on the side as I'm raising my own support. But I know too much now to turn back. I'm committed to using the gifts, the talents, and the abilities that God has given me to do what I can to help and most importantly, serve my Canada, our Canada, true north, strong, and free. I discover every day that Canada is a mission field, and despite what we see on the TV, despite what we read in the newspapers, that God sees the big picture. And often I'm reminded that my world is so small, and we must not let our humanity prevent us from seeing the big picture, from seeing an accurate picture of what is actually happening. We need to look beyond the negative, because if we look for God, we will find evidence of him everywhere. Although Daniel was in the midst of a very secular and chaotic society, he refused to conform, but instead he prayed. And when he did, Jesus showed up in the midst of the fire, a and the lions shut up. As we become broken for the things that break God's heart, and we begin to see Canada from his perspective, we'll watch and experience his love controlling and compelling us. Why? Because we are convinced that one died for all, from the Pacific coast to the Atlantic coast, from Resolute Bay way up in northern Canada to the St. Lawrence River. As Pastor Steve mentioned, inscribed on the Great Peace Tower on the walls of our Parliament building, says this scripture, "He shall have dominion from sea to sea and from the rivers to the ends of the earth." A scripture that one of our founding fathers saw as he was doing his devotionals one morning. They were trying to decide what they should call Canada, and so they decided to call it the Dominion of Canada, as he felt this scripture described Canada well. Also on the Peace Tower is the scripture, "Without a vision, people perish." What's your vision this morning? How do you see Canada? As a church, we have a responsibility to stand in the gap, to come alongside, to serve, and to support the many people in many ways, with the most important being that of prayer. Because as I've described already, prayer changes things. Let us pray for good government and celebrate those elected officials who do know Jesus, and be sure that we pray for them. The Bible says where there is moral rot in a nation, the government topples easily, but where there is wise and knowledgeable leadership, there is stability. Let us pray for this kind of leadership, that God would give them the grace and the wisdom they need to serve us in this capacity. Let us pray that God would give all of us eyes to see this great nation and our neighbors in both the north and the south through the lens not of the world, but rather through the lens of God. And let us pray that God would continue to pour out his blessing upon our nation, that we may be an example here in Canada of healing and reconciliation to the nations of the world that look to us for leadership. Let us celebrate and never forget our home in native land. Let us never take it for granted. May God keep our land, true north, strong and free. And may God bless Canada.
I want to take the opportunity to pray for Ken as he steps into this role. I think it's certainly something that warrants him to be able to do it full time, and there's a lot of work that needs to be done and a lot of partnerships to be bridged. And I think that there's a reason why God is taking you the route he has over these last 10 years, and you start to see it as the pieces come together. But I want you to stretch your hand if you would want to pray and believe God for favor, for wisdom, for direction for Ken. Father, we just thank you for this opportunity that exists and for the many people that are involved. We pray for favor, for partnerships between True North and other organizations, for wisdom for Ken to be able to relate to people from many different walks of life. We pray for favor, for donations, for those who donate the goods, for those who donate the freight and help with the freight, and for those that will provide and partner with Ken in the finances for his own support. We pray for he and Deb and Olivia as they look to a time when he travels very much back and forth across our land, helping people to understand what can be done and to be the one who connects the need with the one who will meet that need. Father, we ask you to direct, to release wisdom in Jesus' name. Amen. And as a church, we've started to partner with True North as well to support, encourage you to do so as well. There's a lot that can be done, a lot will be done, and it's going to be a broad partnerships across our land to do it. So thanks very much, Kim, for sharing with us. Just before we close, I want you to see a music video that has been recorded by Kevin Pauls, a song that he wrote. It talks about the beauty of our land, but I want you to think about July 1st is actually halfway through the year. Maybe you made some decisions back in January about this year and about what you're going to do, or decisions you're going to make, or how you're going to live your life, or the purpose and intention. And we cannot go back and change 6 months, what we did or didn't do, anymore. We can go back over 150 years. But we can make a decision about how we're going to live the next 6 months of this year. So as you see this, and as we see the beauty of the land God's given us, let's dream about what God can and desires to do in our land.
We've come this far by faith across the raging sea. Valleys far and wide, and aching to be free. Your grace and majesty is boundless like the plains. Even through sacrifice, our hope it still remains. We believe in the glory, the pride.
We believe that we believe together for God to touch the people of Canada and the people of the world through Canada. You know, we ask ourselves the questions, what would we do? What would we believe for if we knew that God already made every provision for it? What would we do? What could we believe could happen in the city if every one of us reached one person with the gospel? What could happen in Canada if we would together believe and pray and then reach out? There's a lot that needs to be done throughout the world. We're called to go to the nations of the world, and we do that as the nations come here. And we want to pray and believe God together that he will use each one of us. We are called to not hold up a banner of division, but unity. And really, unity can only come when we realize that we're all made in the image of God. And when we come to a place where we set aside the personal agendas and we realize that we are called to walk together. It's the gospel that allows us to be free from the past in all aspects and to receive the healing that comes, really, that truly sets free. It's possible to be in a free land possible to have the potential of freedom and not enjoy it. The gospel is to set us free from the past, to actually make different decisions going forward. I pray that in these next 6 months of this year, that we will choose to live more intentionally, that we will pray more passionately, and that we will continue to believe that God can do exceedingly above all we could ask, dream, hope, or desire. I'm going to invite you to bow your heads if you would. I'm going to pray a prayer. We'll pray a prayer of rededication out loud together. But perhaps some of you may pray this for the very first time. Heavenly Father, out loud together. Heavenly Father, thank you for your love and for your forgiveness, for your mercy and for your grace. Thank you that you revealed yourself to us and given to us abundant life. We thank you that today, that there is one name under heaven, Jesus, whereby men might be saved. You desire us to know you intimately and for it to change the decisions we make and change the way that we live. May it be so for your honor and glory. Amen. If you're here today and you prayed that for the very first time and you meant that receiving God's mercy and grace, why don't you just wave at us for a moment, because we want to welcome you to the family of God. It starts with a decision, but it's a lifelong journey and walk. God's desire is that you might know him and that you might know him personally and intimately today. Church, we realize that we have a responsibility, that the choices we make and the lives that we live do count, do make a difference. Would we stand together, please? We're going to sing this final song together. And as we do, leaders, if you'd come to the front, make yourself available for prayer. We invite you, no matter what the area of life, issue in life may be today, invite you to come forward for prayer and receive prayer. Because God hears and answers. So as we sing this song, leaders, come with you, please. Direct you and use you to touch other people's lives in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.